you don't mind. I go by the name of Q Billy, your Mella, your man. If Billy can't do it, then nobody can. You feel me? And now you're watching EC Sports.
Yeah, yo, check it. Turn me up a little bit on the mic.
Oh boy, EC Sports episode 64. Actually, you know what? I'm a boss. I can restart everything. Episode 1. You like that Zen? Episode Justin Fields. How about we go there since we got college football happening? And when you're the boss or whatever, you know, director of content. Then you chief of content, sorry, you could change things up. I'm going to start doing the show by myself for a while just to, release anything. I'm not saying anyone's gone. I'm not saying anything is different. I just want to do a few shows solo just to, get my feet wet, so to speak. I still got my boy Danny and Callie giving you the 2-minute drill, but I'm going to check some stuff out myself. I got to let Dylan focus on becoming a quarterback and school. So we'll go from there. Today, we're going to discuss some easy things. The Bears. I'm going to go a little more in depth because I know you guys watched the show. Or for those that watched the show, you know how I feel about them. But I'm going to let you know how everything started and everything and why we are where we are. We're going to talk about some NFL playoffs. Some things happened. I made some bets that didn't go as I wanted them to, but that's what comes with gambling. When you gamble, you're gambling. Therefore, that's what happens. And then if we have time, we'll get into basketball. It's a very tough season so far. Hard to watch, hard to keep up with. It's just different without fans, and I'm starting to see that a lot of things that you've had before and that you miss are huge. So let's get it started, man. The Bears somehow made the playoffs and they literally fucked up. So, all year we've been discussing how the Bears would not win double digits. I knew that from jump, but I was still, as any other Chicago person, was falling back on the D. Pause. Oh my geez, sorry. But when you have an NFL team and they understand, the process and why you do it, the whole point of doing it is going to the playoffs, if I'm not mistaken. So when the Bears somehow fell back into the playoffs after losing to the Green Bay Packers, as everyone suspected, of course, my Bears fandom in my mind said, hey, we're going to go in there and we're going to show the Packers who we are. But yeah, that lasted about a quarter. But the Bears still somehow, with what happened, made the playoffs. So with them making the playoffs, they ended up heading out to New Orleans. Now, one thing I'm going to say, and I never understood, and I've always disliked, is this. People saying, the Bears are 2-0 against New Orleans. So, not this team. Not this team before that team. Why are we talking about being 2-0 with the teams that went to the Super Bowl? Like, keep that shit out of here. It does not matter. Not one player from this team was on that team. So that's not even something that should be mentioned. But for some reason, my colleagues in the media still mention that bullshit. But yeah, no one cared that the Bears were 2-0 against Now, if they wanted to say Drew Brees is 0-2 against the Bears, I mean, I guess they could say that, but still, just because he's there doesn't mean that the team that he's playing is the team that is 2-0 against them, because it matters about that team. But anyway, the Bears go into it. Every fan in Chicago, even though they hate the Bears and what they're doing, they're still Bears fans. Now, let me branch off and talk a little about Bears fandom, okay? When you grew up in my age group, I'm in my 40s now, you grew up watching the Chicago Bears with Mike Ditka. You were old enough to see the 85 Bears win back in the day, okay? So your mind says, I'm a Bears fan because of Walter Payton, because of Mike Ditka, because of the 85 Bears and what they did after that. The Bears weren't trash after the 85 Bears, although a lot of people felt like they should have at least won one more. Didn't happen, but the Bears did maintain a decent team after that. We went to, after Walter, rest in peace, retired, we went over to Neil Anderson. Then we had Raymond, the ultra back Harris. We had, who else? Tom, I forgot his name, but he's the other running back that went to the playoff, the Super Bowl. We had Cedric Benson. As much as you want to hate, he did have a couple good years with us. We had Brandon Marshall. We had Curtis Conway. We had some decent teams. So after Ditka left, we went, I think, Wanstead. I'm not remembering, but I know we had Dave Wanstead. We had a lot of coaches. Let's just leave it at that. A lot of coaches that didn't really do well. Lovey came in, and Lovey at least brought a winning culture to Chicago. So, you know, fans were happy. Fans were, you know, excited. We had drafted Urlacher, a safety out of New Mexico, turned him into the middle linebacker that the Bears are synonymous for. And we started winning games and, you know, going 10-6 here, 11-5 there, keeping up with the other teams, you know, in our division. Minnesota, Detroit always, Green Bay's always been an issue, but, you know, the Bears are keeping it respectable. So, you know, they, at the time, at the 2000, I forgot what year it was, man, but when they went to the Super Bowl, I was managing a sports bar in Wicker Park. It was fun times. We had people come in on Sunday. We play the song when they score a touchdown, and, you know, Devin Hester was doing his thing. So, it was just a lot of, like, interest in the Bears, right? Jay Cutler was here. He's a quarterback that, you know, wins games. He has a great arm. He puts numbers up. He has that personality. But, you know, whatever you want to say about Smoke and Jay, he was winning games, and he was doing his part. So, we got to the point where, you know, we had a good chance. So we made it all the way to the NFC Championship against our biggest rival, the Green Bay Packers. And somehow, some way, we didn't make the Super Bowl. We lost by 3. Jay Cutler got hurt. I always, you know, throw some shade out there, but you can never knock anybody. You don't know how they're feeling, you know, it's a knee, but, you know, we go from there. Ever since then, you know, the Bears kind of went down, but I'm still a Bears fan. You know, fast forward to the Mitch Trubisky era. I wanted Deshaun Watson because Deshaun Watson came from a winning tradition in Clemson. He was a senior. He had proven himself in the last, not one, but 2 national championships. Dabo Sweeney's a great coach. It's like, it's a fit. It's get the guy. You have a franchise quarterback. You have the spot to get him. Somebody, I forgot who it was, but they were guaranteed number one. And I remember, if I'm not mistaken, there was like a DB, the guy that went to Cleveland. He was pretty much stenciled in for that because it was just the writing was on the wall for the Bears to grab Deshaun. Now, I will never knock them for not getting Pat Mahomes. Pat Mahomes was very athletic, well-known, and everybody thought he was a good passer, but no one knew that he was going to be Pat Mahomes. So I'm not going to sit here and be like, how did you not draft Pat Mahomes? He was already like stated he was going to go late first round, early second. So it's the Bears were like number four, right? But Deshaun Watson was definitely someone that you just cannot miss up. It's you have to look at where they played, right? I kept hearing about Mitch Trubisky. You know, he's played well, but at the end of the day, he's only had, 8 to 12, I think it was 12 starts since high school. He went to North Carolina. North Carolina isn't something to piss on, but it's not Clemson. It's not that competition, and he definitely was not in the national championship the previous 2 years. So not sure what Ryan Pace was thinking, but he chose to trade up because for some strange reason, he thought that someone was going to take Mitch Trubisky at number two. So he trades the number three for number two to San Francisco, and the Mitch Trubisky era begins. His rookie season, he had a fluke Pro Bowl season. Honestly, I don't deem that a Pro Bowl season. I just think he did what he was supposed to do. But it wasn't something that was, you know, any interest. John Fox and Ryan Pace chose this guy. And, you know, Deshaun Watson ended up in Houston. Of course, he flourishes. He does what he was expected to do with the team that wasn't really good, but he had DeAndre Hopkins. I feel like you bring in Deshaun Watson, who's a guaranteed franchise quarterback, and then you build. That's something you can build on. I don't think you can build on Mitch Trubisky, but that's what the Bears chose to do. Bring in Nagy. As you can see, I'm kind of speedballing. But you bring in Nagy, a guy who's got some good resume behind him with Andy from KC. Can't knock him. He's got Super Bowl championships. He's got a winning pedigree. Guys under him have went on and won. So, you know, your excitement kind of builds, even though you still don't, as a fan, have a confidence that you want in your quarterback. Green Bay, confidence in their quarterback. Houston, confidence in their quarterback. Kansas City, confidence in their quarterback. Tampa Bay, obviously having the greatest of all time at the helm, you have confidence in your quarterback. So a Chicago person does not, because we don't know what we're going to get, right? To the point where the guy couldn't keep his starting spot when he was winning. He was actually 6-0, I think, and he still lost his spot, and they brought in Nick Foles. First of all, you bring in Nick Foles and pay him the money you do, you're telling him, hey, we don't have any confidence in our quarterback, be ready to play, right? Foles comes in, you know, puts a little excitement in Chicago, and then he kind of like falls back to what he is. Let's be real. Nick Foles is a career number two. That's what he's gotten you. Yes, he won a Super Bowl, but as a number two, Carson Wentz played most of that year. And it was a situation where he actually signed with Jacksonville to be their guy, and he lost his spot to Gardner Minshew. Yeah. So that within itself should tell you what the Bears were thinking when they brought him in. But forward to the end of the season, the Bears make the playoffs somehow, and it's a weird feeling. It's like that feeling you get sometimes when there's like this fight that you feel should have happened years ago, and you say, I'm not going to watch that shit. And then the day comes, and you're like, man, I gotta get this fight. You know, I've had this conversation before on the show, but that's how it feels when the Bears are in the playoffs. You can't not watch if you're a diehard Bears fan. I have another podcast. I told them I can't shoot until the game is over or early enough before, because it's the Bears, man. You got to see, what are they going to come out? Are they going to do something? And as good as New Orleans is, they don't really like scare you. You know, it's not like you're going right into Green Bay, because Green Bay had a bye. So New Orleans comes out. Sorry if I said New England earlier, but New Orleans comes out and they, you know, it's like a feeling out process. They didn't score. Bears stopped them. Bears come out 3 and out. That's pretty much what they did the whole game. Actually, I think they didn't make a third down conversion until the end of the game at the 2 minute warning, which is embarrassing. New Orleans scores in the first half. They get a touchdown. I think it was Michael Thomas, who hadn't played most of the year, breeze over to him right up the middle. For some strange reason, the Bears leave him wide open. Don't understand that. We were down our best tackler in Roquan Smith, and in my opinion, our best receiver in Darnell Mooney, the rookie. So coming in with that, that was very underrated situation, but you know, we go in. So Bears come out, they're down 7-0, and lo and behold, they throw a trick play in. I'm wondering about your bitch. He's lined up on the receiver side, but he comes. He makes a pivot, gets back around. They toss it to him, and they throw a bomb. Well, he throws a bomb. Mims wide open in one-on-one coverage. Trubisky drops it right into his lap, and he freaking Mims drops the ball. As a Bears fan, that was a telltale, because I knew the game was over right there. That was their only chance. That would have changed the complexion of the game. New Orleans would have had to play. They would have had to. They were tied. It was like second quarter. The defenses were holding each other. It was already seemed to be a game that wasn't going to be high scoring. They were holding Drew Brees, down, and Kamara wasn't really doing anything. So once that play happened, I'm not blaming it on the kid, but you got to make that catch, man. You're in the NFL. You're a wide receiver. Your job is to catch the ball. That deflated, I'm sure, a lot of people, and it made me understand why I don't like the Bears. I am not happy with what we're doing. I don't understand why we can't, as a organization, get a franchise quarterback that will be a franchise quarterback, not from another team, but draft one. Green Bay drafts their people. That's why they're perennial. That's why every season they're competing. You cannot bring in a free agent. You can't bring in some bum from another team and think he's gonna, you know, get his career back on track. You have to work through the draft. And I don't know if they understand the importance of it, but all they have to do is look freaking down to 294 in Green Bay and understand that you're not going to win if you don't win through the draft. And the fans are tired. The fans are disgusted. Nagy is not the guy. I never understood a coach that would ever throw his players under the bus or just not take full autonomy for what's going on, right? So that's the Bears in a nutshell and how I feel about them. I'm sorry I spent a long time with it, but if you don't understand it, then it's just, you know, my guys will be like, bro, what did you expect and all this? It's like you were watching too, bro. Like you had a feeling in that second quarter, like, wow, they're sticking with them. They have a chance. And it's like, man, just beat my ass. Don't make me believe that you're going to try. But it was tough to watch. So it was a hard pill to swallow, but that was the end of that season. And as quick as possible, how that happened is funny as well. But the NFL does move on. I mentioned him early, Tom Brady, the greatest. He has New Orleans. He's 0-2 against them this year. So that's a huge situation. Kansas City finally comes back. They got a really tough team to play. Can't think of it off. All Cleveland, they looked really tough. Made Pittsburgh look bad. Who else? Buffalo is playing Baltimore. Still not a big fan of Baltimore and what they do, but you know what? They won the game. Buffalo kind of gave away the game. They were up 2 touchdowns. Josh Allen, sometimes he kind of overdoes it. So I'm interested to see what they do next week. Green Bay is Green Bay. They got a team in it's drawing a blank, but I do know Brady and Breeze are playing each other. And Green Bay has their game. If it comes to me prior to us leaving, I'll let you know. But it doesn't look like a tough game for Aaron Rodgers. So right now, it looks as if, in my opinion, it's going to end up at Aaron Rodgers versus Tom Brady to see who goes to the Super Bowl, which would be interesting. Green Bay has a couple of tough losses this year. They're not invincible. And neither is Tampa Bay, but getting AB in there and him scoring and having the weapons that Brady has, I'm looking forward to see what happens. Kansas City is playing at the top of their game. I find it hard for any team, and I'd be remiss to see that a team has a chance, but we'll see what happens with that. Finishing up. We talk about NBA, their protocols and the COVID, everything with no bubble, things are, going as some thought. The Bulls Celtics just got canceled. I think another New Orleans game was canceled. Until this COVID shit is done, you're going to continuously see different things affected. Adam Silver and NBA said they set the schedule in place for this situation, so they're not going to pause the season. It's just weird, man. Like, without fans, even just watching it on a game, it just looks like it doesn't look right, right? I know it's the players. I know all of that, but I am not in the same ilk of, oh, we get to see this. You want to see the full spectrum, not just, oh, at least they're playing a game. And that's not something I want, man. I want the teams to be on the floor with the fans, with the concessions, with the fun, the atmosphere. That's the NBA. You know, this is the NB. It's like no association or something, but it's tough to watch, but you know, with the vaccine out and everything, it'll probably take another season, but I am definitely interested in seeing how the back to normal looks. So, but we are in transition, so I'm looking forward to it. Even with EC Sports coverage, it's like I want to get back in there and I want to be able to, you know, go to the Bulls games, cover, and just see how it goes. But that's that. Hope you guys enjoyed it. You know, it's like an intimate setting. And, you know, I like this. You know, I like, it's like I'm talking to my people. You feel me? But we're going to head over to Cali. Danny's going to offer his 2 minutes plus to what he thinks about the NFL right now and the state of the NBA. And I'm sure much more. Appreciate you guys. It's Dion, EC Sports. I'll see you next week.
What's going on, everybody? It's your host for the EC Sports West 2 Minute Drill, Daniel Malik-Ismail, and we're finally back. Winter break is over. Now it's time to get back at it. What's going on, Dion? How you been? Hope you had a great holiday. Hope you had a great new year. Let's get it started. Let's kick things off with the college football final. We had Alabama completely dominate Ohio State by 4 touchdowns, a 28-point victory. Devontae Smith looked like the Heisman, of course, recording over 12 catches, doing his thing. Najee Harris with a spectacular performance. Alabama's got 4 first-round picks on their offense alone in skill players. Now, how many Alabama players will get drafted as a whole? Who knows? I think in the first round, they'll probably have anywhere from 4 to 5. In the total draft, they're going to for sure have the most players drafted. This was a stacked team, a stacked class. Shout out to the Alabama Crimson Tide for winning it again. College football wasn't the only football played this week. Last Saturday and Sunday, for the first time, the NFL had its Super Wild Card weekend that featured 3 matchups on each day. Now, we had some great matchups, some like the Buffalo Bills, who came out victorious, winning their first playoff game since 1994. The Rams upsetting the Seahawks. That was another great game. Great defensive battle by the Rams defense. And Chase Young's Washington football team taking on Tom Brady's Bucks. And Tom Brady, of course, does what he has to do, takes care of business in round one, and moves on. Now, on Sunday, you had the Baltimore Ravens taking on the Titans, which was a slugfest, and the Ravens pulled that off. Lamar Jackson gets his first career playoff win. And then moving on into the second match of the Bears and the Saints. I'm so sorry, Dion, but the Bears looked like a team that they didn't even deserve to be there. Mitch Trubisky did throw a really nice dime that was dropped. And finally, the matchup that didn't really stun us that much, but it was just the turn of the tide with the Cleveland Browns upsetting the Pittsburgh Steelers. The Browns dominated all facets, starting off the gates with a quick 28-0 lead and then carried that on into the fourth quarter into a victory. Now for the Steelers, doesn't look too good for Big Ben in his future. And for Juju Smith, stop dancing on TikTok, start winning games. So that was your Super Wild Card weekend for the NFL. And that'll wrap things up here at the EC Sports West 2 Minute Drill. We had a lot to cover, especially on the gridiron for football. We got another great, exciting week of playoff football coming up. So, Dion, salute.